It's progressive time, ladies and gentlemen, progressive time. So, I got one little short story to tell you before we begin the speakers for the evening. In recent times, you will have heard the other side speaking about some independence that they support. Now, I don't have a problem with any individual who is an independent. I don't. But 1 week, they're getting up saying it don't even think about looking at the independence because you can't operate a government with independence. And then somebody whispers, but what happens if you don't get enough to form a government? And the light bulb went off. Oh my God, I best not ostracize these independents because I might need them to form a government. So the tune has changed now, and I am supporting this independent, that one, the next one, the other one, and the other one. And ladies and gentlemen, I can't blame them for trying that stunt, because when you look at their side, truthfully, it's nothing compared to our side. But it tells the tale that because there's only one right side, Cayman has to ensure that Premier gets enough people to form the government without, oh, they're not cooking no turtle meat again. Not doing it. Tried it once in novice form. And when I tell you it didn't work, I mean it didn't work. So we want none of that. We don't want to do that. When we go cook that turtle meat, that's just to eat. Nothing else. And have a good time. And during breadfruit season. So, the message, absolutely, Uncle Bill. Absolutely. Would never forget you. And after May the 24th, we're going to go a little Cayman. We're going to make you relax. We're going to catch us a couple of snappers, bring them so that you can cook for that evening. No problem. Ladies and gentlemen, that is a very serious message. And it is only to say to you that while we have 19 individual constituencies and everybody only has one vote, when you are looking at who you need to vote for in the constituency that you have to vote in, you need to look at the bigger picture at the same time. You need to understand that a government cannot be formed just so. You need to elect a government who has agreed on their policies already. And in this specific instance, you need to re-elect this government who has taken us out of darkness and shown us light. So let me move on, since we are a little bit late in starting. And first of all, I'd like to invite to the podium Dr. Linda Macfield, who is going to give a very nice endorsement for Miss Lucille. And while she's coming up to the podium, let me tell you, ladies and gentlemen, Dr. Macfield is a champion. She has faced every adversity that you would wish to think about, but her immense faith in God has kept her going. And she is certainly one for all of us to emulate and to look up to. Thank you, Dr. Macfield.
Protocol having already been established, I will just say good evening, pleasant good evening to everyone. This evening, it is my pleasure to have been asked to endorse my friend, Lucille Del Seymour, whom I've known for over 50 years. When we were both much younger and more beautiful, and she can still dance, I can't. Okay. But Lou, over those years, I have had the opportunity to work on various committees and boards with Lucille. And I have seen the passion and the compassion for her country, for the youth and the elderly, especially of these islands. Just down the road from us, there's a school called Raid Bay that Lucille fought hard and long when all the workers at Public Works told us that we could not build a school there. Lucille, in her kind way of batting her eyelashes, and she said, "Don't worry about them. We know what we can do as women." And she surrounded herself with a group of women. I was the accountant in the Department of Education at the time, and she delegated different aspects of that project to various women, and we got the job done, and we have Raid Bay School.
Hear, 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 hear.
When, huh? Forgot about that? I don't. I got short hair, but long memory. So, there are so many stories that I could tell you, but in the essence of time, I would just like to say to the people of Prospect, if you want someone who will work diligently, who will put every ounce of effort and energy that she has into protecting these islands and to make sure that we stop warehousing our youth as cattle, as we've been doing in Northwood Prison, then a vote for Lucille Del Seymour will see changes in what we see happening with our young people. Because I know that Lucille, as she have done over the years, will tap into the resources that she has at her disposal, such as mine, because I have worked in the prison for over 40 years. And we have to do something different from what we have been doing for our young people. We have to take care of our elderly and all of those that are in between. But I know that Lucille will make a difference. Hence the reason why I came out of my bed, which I haven't been able to get out of for last couple of days because of my illness, and came out here tonight. I did tell Lou as soon as I finish, I would have to leave. So when you see me leaving, don't go back and say that I walked out after I spoke, okay? I'm letting you know what happened. So all the residents in Prospect, I say to you to join me on the 24th of May as we elect the dancing queen, our Lucille Del Seymour.
Ladies and gentlemen, as I said before, certainly a voice of inspiration. Thank you, Dr. McPhee. Please give her another big round of applause. And now, ladies and gentlemen, I know that you don't want to hear too much from me this evening. I am just here to direct the traffic, and I will do so the best way I know how. Our first speaker tonight is a gentleman who I have known for many, many years, although I was a man before he was. See, yeah, yeah, his father has vivid memories of me when I was a man. Be that as it may, let me say, ladies and gentlemen, that I have been exceedingly proud to have had the opportunity to serve with this good gentleman for the last 4 years as part of the government. He has brought much to the table. He's not a prophet. Certainly is not that. He doesn't profess to be one of those. But certainly he is someone who has great insight because of his vast experience in the private sector. And he brings all of that to the table. Plus, simply put, ladies and gentlemen, he's a good person. He's a kind person. He's a compassionate person. And he cares about this country because, like me, his children and grandchildren are going to be in this country for generations to come, and he wants, while he is here, to do the best he can to make it better, so that by the time people like he and I depart, we can know in our hearts that we have done what is right and have made it better for generations to come. I said that in a kind of somber tone, because the truth is, ladies and gentlemen, while we get all excited and hyped up over the politics, what I just said is what we want in the House. We got one here now. Let's give it to him again. Mr. Roy McTaggart.
Yeah. Ready, music? I need my dance. Thank you, Katie, for those kind words. Thank you, Mr. Traffic Warden. Good evening, Red Bay. Yeah. Good evening, Prospect. Yeah. Good evening, Cayman, and especially to those of you who are watching from home. Tonight, I am truly honored and delighted to be here on stage with my good friends and my political colleagues, Premier Alden McLaughlin and Ms. Lucille Seymour, the progressive candidates for Red Bay and Prospect. I am here to support them in their quest for election to the Legislative Assembly, and I urge you to vote Alden. Vote Lucille. Vote progressives. You know, ladies and gentlemen, today we make a great team, and I'm telling you, they are your best choice to represent you in the Legislative Assembly come May 24th. And when you go to the polls, they are the only choice. But you mark your X anywhere else, it's going to be a spoiled ballot. See, ladies and gentlemen, in many ways tonight, I feel really at home this evening. I have several family members that live in the Prospect area. My brother Arthur, you here? He lives on Marina Drive with his family. For more than 25 years, my mother has lived on Poindexter, next to Moravian Church. And just a stone's throw to the east, my father, Uncle Bill, he's here, and my brother Chris, I think he's 30,000 feet in the air somewhere, flying Miami, Kingston, I don't know, but they live on Patrick's Island. And a little known fact about me, when I was a young man fresh out of university, my first home was on Marina Drive. I lived in this wonderful community for 6 years, and back then, the roads were unpaved. It could often take you 15 minutes when you got off on Mangrove Avenue to get to my home on Marina Drive, near the marina. And finally tonight, I have many friends who live in this great community, several who are here with us. Thank you for welcoming us into your neighborhood. I feel at home. Tonight I'm also a very proud man. I'm proud of the fact that for the past 4 years, I was part of a government that has accomplished and delivered so much for its people, and in such a short period of time. Don't be afraid to disrupt me, please. During the campaign, the opposition is and will continue to attack us, denigrate and malign our characters, casting all kinds of aspersions and untruths about us. But I ask you, ask yourself this question. Why is that? Why would they do it? The simple truth is tonight, ladies and gentlemen, they cannot challenge our record of accomplishment. And what do people do? When they can't attack your message, who do they attack? The messenger. That's why we are being attacked in such awful ways by our opposition. Our record is unquestionable, and it is available and there for all to scrutinize. We have demonstrated conclusively we are a government that gets things done. And so I'm going to pause and ask you at this time, ladies and gentlemen, what time is it? Progressive time! Keep it going, ladies and gentlemen. It's progressive time. But ladies and gentlemen, I wanted, in my allotted time this evening, I really have chosen to speak to you and update the country at large about a subject matter that is very near and dear to my heart, one that I have been working on for the past 2.5 years. Let me talk to you a little bit tonight and just update you on what's going on with our landfill. I'll share with you what we have done and are about to do to address the issues surrounding it. It is truly a subject that I believe is of vital concern to every person in Georgetown. It affects us all. And there is much information out there. And it is time for us tonight to set the record straight. So, you want to talk trash? Let's talk trash. Ladies and gentlemen, in 2015, the Progressive government approved a National Solid Waste Management Program strategy for Cayman. It identifies the important steps and actions that will be taken to deliver the solid waste management solution. The main objective is to have a national system in place that will incorporate the waste hierarchy that first focuses on the waste reduction, and then it examines each subsequent option before getting down to the final action, and that is disposal in the landfill. We will pursue the reduction of waste going in, material going into the waste, into the landfill. We will promote the reuse of goods that people have purchased, checking, cleaning, repairing, refurbishing items, keeping them serviceable and working longer rather than taking them and just dumping them in the landfill just because a battery has worn out or something. In recycling, that is turning waste into a new substance or product, and that includes composting. Recovery, energy is recovered from waste and is fed into the electrical grid. And then finally, the last element, disposal in a landfill. The project of which we are about to embark on, ladies and gentlemen, includes the following elements, with the ultimate aim of reducing the amount of waste going into the landfill by 95%. Let me share with you what we're trying to do. Waste reduction measures to include a very robust and strong waste management education program and pragmatic waste minimization initiatives, such as composting in your own home. Divert stuff away from the landfill. Community recycling depots and household waste recycling center facilities. Composting of yard and garden waste from landscapers and householders. Ladies and gentlemen, do you know that almost a third of the stuff going into the landfill today is yard waste? I'm talking about tree clippings and grass and stuff like that. That's scary. One third of it. It also tells us it's quite easy to divert and keep it and limit what goes in. There is also to be a key element is the treatment of the residual waste in a state-of-the-art waste recovery plant or a waste-to-energy facility. And finally, That place we called it, malign and called a dump or the landfill. Our plan calls for the closure and the remediation of that landfill and the construction of an adjacent and much smaller engineered landfill to handle the residuals that will come from that waste to energy plant. The good news, ladies and gentlemen, is that there is sufficient space remaining there at the landfill to accommodate this. So, ladies and gentlemen, tonight, I can tell you the government is in the final stages of procurement for this solid waste management solution. And it, none too soon, because truly, time is not on our side in terms of dealing with this issue. What we will embark upon is a public-private partnership with a successful bidder being awarded a contract to design, to build, to finance, operate, maintain the facility, with a strong emphasis on providing significant employment opportunities for Caymanians. This will also include a very strong national recycling education program. Last week, final bids were submitted to the Central Tenders Committee for their evaluation and approval of a winning bid. But you know, ladies and gentlemen, in the meantime, your government has not been sitting idly by. Many good things have been done to manage that landfill that were not being done previously up to 2013 and 14. These include, I only have to remember the fires that we encountered when we first took office and how frequent and how severe they were and tested our resources. Remember it well. But what we have done in the intervening time is that we have purchased much needed equipment to ensure that we can deliver and continue to deliver a reliable collection service and actively manage the landfill in such a way that fires and those offensive odors no longer plague us. Recycling of the post-Ivan mound of tires is well on its way. We have delivered that. Voluntary recycling of aluminum, plastic, glass, electronics, and cardboard is ongoing, and it grows every week and every month, with many tons of waste now being diverted away from our landfill. And finally, we have purchased land which will house the waste-to-energy plant that will feed into our electricity grid. And so clearly, ladies and gentlemen, much is being done and is ongoing. And I beg you tonight, ladies and gentlemen, please do not listen to the opposition and the media rants that take place that nothing is being done. You tell them, okay. I don't have the details. They've got their information wrong. Talk about it being a $500 million contract. Nothing of the sort. The number is big, but it can tell you it's not $500 million. And that's right. Ladies and gentlemen, tonight, you can see and you can smell the results of the work that we have done over the last 3 years. That's right. That's right, because a good smell has returned. No foul smell anymore. But ladies and gentlemen, I'm not gonna lie to you. This is a big project. It is huge. The capital cost, the cost of acquiring a waste to energy facility, exceeds 100 million Cayman Islands dollars. It's big. The public management and finance law provides for a very rigid and robust evaluation project for large projects such as this. The reason? The numbers are huge. And it is important that we as a government take the time and get it right the first time. The reason, ladies and gentlemen, when you talk numbers like that, when you have a failed project, the costs are horrendous and it can be a national disaster. And that, ladies and gentlemen, is the one thing we do not want, because I believe firmly in my mind, we have one chance to get it right and we must make it work. But tonight I want to say, we finished talking trash now. Let's talk other things. I am not independent anymore. I am a progressive. See me, sir? Tonight, ladies and gentlemen, it's all about Alden. Tonight, it's all about Lucille. Tonight, it's all about who? The progressives. And may I pause once again and ask you what time it is? I love it. I love it. Ladies and gentlemen, the past 4 years has seen this progressive government, ably led by Premier Alden McLaughlin, manage and lead the affairs of this country in a mature, a professional, and a fiscally responsible manner. No one can deny it. Our record is there to see. Despite the fact that we were hindered by the UK requirements to reduce government spending in each of our first 3 years in office, the economy is growing at an accelerating rate. The private sector is once again investing. Investor confidence has returned to the country. It has. And you know what I found out this past week? More than 2,000 Caymanians have found employment since we took office. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm proud of that. Proud of it. But there's more to do. Our fiscal affairs are being managed in a way in which they have never been managed, in certainly since I have my memory. And then that what that all means now is that government is able to make significant investments in the infrastructure that this country needs to support the growth and expansion that we are experiencing. Times are certainly good and a lot better than they were in 2012 and 2011. In short, ladies and gentlemen, I firmly believe in my heart that we have been good stewards of the country's affairs. At all times, we have acted with honesty, integrity, accountability, and transparency. But you know, ladies and gentlemen, many can only talk about these attributes. But we, the progressives, we live them every day. And I'm proud to identify myself with them. This election is all about stark contrast and clear choices. Tonight, you can choose honesty, integrity, transparency, and accountability. You can choose progressives, or you can choose to return to the failed attitudes and behaviors that we were so resoundingly rejected by the country in 2013. Which one do you want? Progressives, it is time, and it is our progressive time. I said this last week, and I'm going to say it again because it needs to be hammered home. Cayman, there is not much that can be said by way of criticism about a government that has been scandal-free, we have been corruption-free, and if you give us 4 more years, we'll almost be debt-free. I need it. Ladies and gentlemen, we need 4 more years. Our work has just begun. We have dealt with the most pressing issues in our first term of this government. We have taken and dealt with what absolutely had to be dealt with first of all. And there are many things that we would have liked to have done, but time did not allow us. And that's why tonight I'm pleading with you, and I am asking you to give us your support come May 24th. In this election, give us the 4 more years, the 4 additional, not a second term of 4 years, so that we can finish the work that we have started. And that is why tonight, I'm going to ask you and conclude my presentation to you. I'm going to ask you to vote for Alden. You're going to vote for him? You're going to vote for Miss Lou? Vote for Lucille. Who are you voting for? Progressives. Anybody here from Georgetown East? Where? Let me see your hands. I can't see it. Too hot and too bright up here. If you're here from Georgetown East, vote for Roy too. Don't forget me. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for listening to me.
Stand up for your rights. Get up, stand up. Stand up for your rights. Get up, stand up.
Ladies and gentlemen, he's worth more than that. Give it up for Roy. Ladies and gentlemen, didn't want to get crossed up here.
Okay.
What time is it? All right, let's get back in the groove there. I just had a little glitch because I wasn't quite sure who somebody was. And I like to know who your mama is. Ladies and gentlemen, we are moving on up. Roy said a few things that are very, very important. I heard the other night that Cousin Mike was down in Windsor Park saying that the premier was anxious to sign some contract for landfill for $500 million. I'm not going into any details, but you heard what Roy said. But you see, that's the kind of scandal and stuff and propaganda that you hear. Misinformation and such the like. Because you see, as Roy said, they can't argue the facts. So, as usual, they make it up. I have heard with my own ears some of them say, if you can get 10% of the truth, you don't have to worry about anything else. You can say anything else you want to say. But we can't live like that. No. And if it takes that, then they'll have to beat us. But our good Caymanians got good sense and ain't gonna make them beat us because they're going to vote progressives. Now, ladies and gentlemen, moving on. We are going to get another endorsement. And in order to endorse the premier, we'd like to ask Mahalia Seymour to come to the podium to do that. Please welcome her to the podium. She's plenty prettier than I am. She made her mark in Miss Cayman, unlike I did. Ladies and gentlemen, the beautiful Mahalia Seymour.
Thank you for that introduction. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. For those of you that don't know me, I was the second runner-up winner in the Miss Cayman Islands contestant. Okay.
Enter it next year and win it.
I'm too short. This evening, I am honored and privileged to give my personal endorsement for our premier, the Honorable Alden McLaughlin, and for the entire Progressives Party in this upcoming general elections. As a young Caymanian, I feel very proud of all of the work that Mr. McLaughlin has done as our third premier in the past 4 years. Personally, he has done an outstanding job, not only here at home in the Cayman Islands, but also overseas. It has been inspiring to have a progressive government and a premier who's highly capable of running this country, and truly a government that we can all trust. Having leadership skills that we can look up to, and not one sign or issue of corruption in their 4 years in office. Ladies and gentlemen, I think that's something we should all be very proud of. I feel that Mr. McLaughlin and the progressive government have worked very hard to stabilize this country. And we should push forward to get them back in office May 24th. I want to see Mr. McLaughlin and the progressives back in office to finish the job that they all started and to help push the Cayman Islands to become a better community, not only to open doors for young Caymanians, also for bettering the civil that's here with us tonight. I fully support Mr. McLaughlin and the progressives. I believe that they have the power and the commitment to provide the best leadership skills that we know they can accomplish. Lastly, for the love of our country, on May 24th, I will be voting the progressives. And I urge you all to do the same. For those of you on social media, hashtag Cayman Strong, Red Bay, vote Alden McLaughlin. Cayman, vote progressives. Thank you.
Thank you, Mahalia. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, you can do better than that. And ladies and gentlemen, I'm not getting a chance to speak, but that's okay. We have one more endorsement that we need to do right away because we're needing to catch up on time. And certainly I am very, very happy to invite to the podium our long-time colleague, friend, supporter, and everything that's good. Should I say anything more? Ladies and gentlemen, Lawyer Webb.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for coming out, Red Bay and Prospect. I welcome you all this evening. It is my honor to endorse Ms. Lucille Seymour as a progressive candidate for Prospect. I have known Ms. Lucille for a long, long time. If I was to tell you, I'd be giving away my age and her age. And you know ladies don't like to tell their ages. But Ms. Lucille is my good friend. She's a very caring person. And you know, if she didn't care about the young, she would never have become a teacher. And she was Cayman's first trained teacher for the deaf. She spent a long, long time in education, teaching at the primary school. She was principal for Georgetown Primary, and then she moved into the education administration. But Ms. Lucille is a very caring and giving person. She has always sought to lift up and to empower the young and the old. Ms. Lucille felt that the best way to empower young people was through sports, and she founded the Cayman Islands Netball Association. And through that medium, she lifted up and taught many young girls in Georgetown how to behave, how to progress in life, how to become ladies. And she didn't forget the men either. She also lifted them up. She wanted every person to do as good as she did or even better. Ms. Lucille is a great candidate. I endorse her for the Prospect community and all the Prospect voters. I am going to vote for Ms. Lucille, and I want every one of you to vote for her too. And those of you in other districts, if you have any family members in Prospect, tell them to vote for Ms. Lucille.
Yes.
Red Bay residents, vote for our premier, Mr. Alden McLaughlin. And in the rest of Cayman, vote progressive. I will vote progressive. You vote progressive too. We need to put them back in to give us 4 more years of good government. So ladies and gentlemen, vote progressive. Vote Cayman Strong.
Thank you very much, Adriana. Can you hear me in the back? All right. Thank you, Adriana. And Adriana is perfectly right. What time is it?
Progressive!
Who Who are you going to vote for? Gee, that, no better? I know the cure for you all, because you can't see who and who is here. Barbara, come up here. Joey, come on. David. Maxine. Where's David? Mind you, is Miss Daphne here?
Yeah.
Come on up, Daphne. You see, my problem is afraid to say anybody else because everybody might come up. But I think I can afford to say so now. Do we have any other candidates? Not any other candidates. Any other progressive candidates here? I think that's it. I know somebody else is on the way. Just give me 1 second, let me arrange. Have everything now? We have for everybody now? Everybody sit down, let's see. All right.
The crowd looked good for us.
You see this little sea of red? You see this little sea of red? I thought for a minute whether I should leave them to talk with you all, but this is all about getting them elected, so let's keep them in the limelight. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Music Man, this lady, you can't miss on her. You got to introduce her with the music. You heard an endorsement for her. Let me tell you very quickly a few other things about her. There is no one who will hold on to something and don't let go better than her. It doesn't matter what the obstacles are that she faces. If she believes in the cause, she is going wherever that cause goes. If she believes in a thing, she's going where that's going. And let me tell you something. She is a progressive through and through and through and through again. And you know what, ladies and gentlemen? On top of all of that, when you compare her competition to her, there is no competition. And she is one of six wonderful ladies on our team. The right team. Ladies and gentlemen, Miss Lucille Del Seymour.
So amazing how this world was made. I wonder if God is a woman. The gift of life astounds me to this day. I give it up for the woman.
Good evening, everybody. Good evening, those that are streaming. I don't know if this streaming has any writing, but the one that was on last night was doing a lot of writing, saying some derogatory things about everybody. It seems as that's what we do now. We don't think that we can say something nice about somebody. And this is not how the Cayman Islands is. So one thing I want to say here tonight is that we have to learn to say nice things about each other. and we will win. If we say the Honorable Premier is not going to win, keep saying it, and the competition is going to win, it's a self-fulfilling prophecy. We don't want that to happen.
But you go win and the Premier go win.
But I need you. We need you. I want to transfer some of my energy to you tonight. Because I have a lot of it. And I got it from an old lady. And I felt tonight, because I'm streaming, I'm going to talk a little bit about my childhood, because it seems that my competition doesn't know much about me. So let me remind him that my mother was Maud Seymour. Well, he called me old, and he said that I have old thoughts. If you know me, I'm not like that. My mom worked at the hospital. She used to test the urine. You know what that other word is, right? for the semen. And then she would clean the place. She used to call herself a dirt cleaner. Well, one day, and this is something that I will remember all my life. One day, one lady came. My mother sold everything except her children. And that is true. She was an entrepreneur. Christine is just like her. She was selling eggs, and a lady came up and she said, Miss Marty, I want 2 dozen eggs. And I looked at my mother, and I always called her Miss Marty. I said, Miss Marty, that's 24, you know. So the lady said, well, what is it, one smart? I got some work down the yard that you don't want me to send her to you, or send her to me, and I will give her a little work. Those of you who know my mother knew that she had the cleanest mouth in the world. My mother wrapped those eggs up, packed them in that lovely little bag, and she started the worra, 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 worra. My Lucille is going to college. The lady laughs at her and looks at her and says, going to college? But mother, you know that word. She said, I don't know it. Never seen it. But you see them Jamaica doctors and nurses where I work? They went there. And that's where I want my Lucille to go. The rest is history. So I want to tell my competition that I was brought up by a woman who would run through fire, run, do anything in this world so that her Christine and her Lucille and her Ella in particular could get education. I want him to know that she brought us up to like old people. Every Saturday, we had to go and do their jobs for them. And I want him to know that she brought us up to be altruistic. Sorry, that's the wrong pronunciation. I'll say to you in a minute. Altruistic.
That's right.
That is the correct word. You know, we all can make mistakes, you know. And I want you to know that, because we have a way of, when a person makes a mistake or they stumble, we say they're doing wrong and we're failing. I heard it at the debate the other night. They said it about me too, because it was a word I couldn't understand. I have a little stammer, you know that. You didn't know that, but I'll tell you now.
Doesn't change the heart.
My mother married a man. He was a philanderer, a beautiful man, tall, 6'3". He was a Seymour. He loved his children. He went to sea, he went to the American, on the American ships, and he went on the local ships. But he had one failing. He was a spousal abuser. And my mother knew how hard that was for her children. You know, when you have that ill, how it destroys people. My mother dealt with us, her children, to ensure that it did not have a repercussion on us. I wanted to tell you that tonight. Not too many people know that, because I'm a very private person. But I had to say that tonight, because it seems that we take these things for granted. It seems that we like these things, especially your women and your men. This is wrong. It's wrong for children. I'm lucky to be here tonight and not some crazy girl, because my mother beat my father so much. When he hit her, the blood would just pour. You recognize that? Don't feel sorry for me, I'm fine. She's fine too. She never spoke to him for the rest of her life. But she looked after him, because he beat her up so much. It's a terrible thing to do, people. Terrible, it destroys the children in this country. And we wonder why they don't learn. It destroys the women, and they take away their confidence from them. I know that. I lived with my mother. I had a prop her up. We had a stroker, because that poor woman's whole demeanor had been destroyed. Now you are going home tonight, and you're going to think about what I tell you, because we want a better Cayman. Cayman that has upward social mobility. Thank you, thank you, thank
you. Drink your water and tell them. Drink your water and tell them.
My mother made sure that Christine and I did not become the forgotten Caymanians, nor did we fall through the cracks. And this is another thing I want to say to you tonight. From the time I was 10, I developed myself for politics. I looked at my mother one night. It was Mr. Duncan Merrin was there. And while he was talking, I looked at her and I said, I'm going to be a politician. She laughed at me. Unfortunately, she never saw that. But she knew that politics is not just jumping in and saying, I'm going to be a politician. She knew it has to do a lot with community building. And anybody that just jumps into the politics like that, unless they have gone through this process, you be careful. I'm telling you this, and I'm going to tell you another thing. I won't tell you how much money I have, but I can tell you I don't have nobody looking after me. I don't have nobody giving me no money for nothing. I don't have nobody giving me no furniture for nothing. The two little things that the PPM have, I can tell you that much. And let me tell you, while I'm not going to court to prove it, but I want them to take me there, because they would have to prove it. Let me tell you that when a country comes to this level, and this is bad, when you don't work, you never work for a long time. You get a lot of money. You're working, you're running for politics. You look at the poor people. The audacity to look at poor people and say, I'm going to make your life better. My. How can that happen? Ladies and gentlemen, I know you came out here to hear me talk about all kinds of things, but I decided tonight, just this evening, I changed my mind. I decided tonight that this is it. I'm streaming and I'm going to make them down there see and hear what I have to say, not just you. I also, my competition said that I had not done any work with the young people. That's what my competition said. Now you are saying, whoa, but you should say that out there too.
That's right.
Not just here, because you are our mouth. You are our voice. You have to say what you know about us out there. And I am asking you, I am pleading to you, I am telling you that you have to say the positive things and what you know. Because the competition, my competition is a spin doctor. My competition for years have gotten people's ideas, put them together, and made them his, and now saying to the people, I can do that for you. Now listen, my Caymanians were not born on the Twin Pussy Nothing, excuse me, please. As a matter of fact, you might laugh at me, but that was told to me in Jamaica when I went to school in Jamaica, because they say you can always tell a person if they understand that somebody has doubled. So I know you are not stupid. I know Cayman people are very, very smart, and you are not going to take that. I know you are not going to take that, and I don't want you to take that, because if never in your life was it so important for you, it's this time. This is an historic time in the history of the Cayman Islands. Never before have we had one person, one vote. Never before have you, as the premier will possibly tell you, I hope he has time to do that, because I know he has a whole plate to talk about. But never before are we going to take single members constituency where we devolve, give some of that responsibility to the people of the electoral district. And it's that man, I shouldn't say that, it's the premier who puts it in his manifesto. So I wouldn't say it would happen on the 25th of May, but I'm sure by the time January or February comes in next year, we will have our laws passed for our district councils. That is what we are going to introduce in this country. We changing the political system does not mean that you only vote. That's all you do in politics sometimes. But this is going to be different. In this dispensation, the people you select are going to work within your electoral district to help the representative and the civil servants to work and make life better at the local level. Never in the history of the Cayman Islands. I heard Mr. Heseev said something the other day, but that was maybe 100 years ago, but where he talked about district council. But the district council is going to be active. That is something that I am championing. That is something that every district person here is going to champion, to give you, the residents and the voters, an opportunity to help govern. So we are changing the governance of the Cayman Islands. Don't you think that's beautiful? I think so. I really think so. And I want to tell you a little secret. I came out the block a long time before them because I wanted something, to get something in my head. And you know what the people of Prospect said? They said the same thing when I went around with the survey and concretized by our learned premier. Ladies and gentlemen, there are a lot of things that Prospect want. Prospect has an issue with being fearful of criminal activity. It has an issue that they can't leave their wonderful homes and go out to work and come back and not find a window broken or something stolen. Well, you know, in my time growing up, that never happened. So all of that is certainly surprising to me, who came up in a different kind of life. Now, the councils, along with the people who are elected for those councils, will be working on that. I am not up here to tell the details of it, because that wouldn't be fair to you. But I will only give the generalities of it. The Prospect people have spoken about the traffic. We live in a beautiful area that takes 10 minutes to get to town, and it can take an hour. It can take an hour and a half. Sometimes it takes later. And we are working. I know the premier spoke to the commissioner of police, and the commissioner of police was with the Crossbreck group. Those of you should go and join that. They brought the commissioner of police up, and he did agree that he was going to look into the matter. And what the people of Prospect said, they said they want to see the presence of the police walking around or driving around or riding around or whatever around they can do. They want to see that because that's an issue. The Prospect people also said that they don't have anywhere for their children to go and play or interact, nor the seniors. The Prospect people said that. The Prospect people said that they would love to put together something for the risk takers, you know, boys in particular, risk takers. And when they reach 13, 14, 15, they are real risk takers, so they do things that we might not appreciate. But at the end of the day, they are our children, so we have to make sure that we can move them into the right direction. And they have asked if we can find certain areas so that the little ones and the not so little ones can have areas to play. Those are the things that the Prospect said. But ladies and gentlemen, I've only given you a few things, but the good one that the Prospect people talked about was being part of a group with core government and its representative so that they can make decisions at local level. And I think that's good. But I'm here tonight also to ask you. I don't want you to look at the grays in my hair. I kind of did something about them today. But I don't want you to look at that. Because if you think that you're not going to get where I am, then you're dead. And I don't want you to think that. I'm glad I'm the age I am because I'm wiser, I'm smarter, I'm sexier, I'm everything. So, tonight, with these wonderful persons that are here, I am asking you on May 24th to vote progressive. If you like, not if you like, and you should like, where the country is going. Because I can tell you, 50 million Frenchmen can't be wrong.
And all the Frenchmen say going right.
And they say going right. So if it's going right, what about another little term? Just get another little term. But also, I want you to vote for Lucille Seymour for Prospect. And I can't forget my friend, Alden McLaughlin for Red Bay. Because together, we are going to make it happen. Thank you.
So amazing how this world was made. I wonder if God is a woman.
That's me.
Right.
The gift of life astounds me to this day. I give it up for the woman. She's the constant thing that fills my soul. That woman.
Before I get to him, let me tell you something. That was Lucille Del Seymour at her best. Wasn't nasty. Just truthful. That's all. Ladies and gentlemen, please give Miss Lucille a big round of applause. And now that the last chair is filled, and mind you, I talked to him on the phone this evening. I promised him I wasn't going to tease him. I was going to leave him alone. Anyway, ladies and gentlemen, when you say tease ya, you don't want me to tell him about the barbershop and all that tonight. Don't bother with that. Ladies and gentlemen, our own Minister of Finance, Minister Archer, is here. And so, before we go further, we have another endorsement, and I have been keeping one eye on him all evening, and he's been like this on the seat, ready to get up, waiting for his name to be called. Premier is telling me also, because we know him well, and he's a good, good guy. But Premier is telling me he ordered this red shirt he got on specially from Miami. Was it through Amazon? Cayman Airways. Wonderful. Ladies and gentlemen, I agree with you, sir. Our next endorser who will endorse our Premier, Mr. Brian Bodden. Also known as BB.
First of all, I'd like to just say that I can feel the love in this crowd. Okay? For the love of country. As Alden would say, because he hath founded upon the sea, and it is Kurt's ship that brought us here with an experienced crew and a captain like Alden. Okay? The ship of progressive. I'm here to endorse Alden McLaughlin. He is my friend, and he is a great person overall, and I have just a few words to say. When I was asked if I could endorse him, it was basically, Alden is not a complicated individual. The Alden we all know is foremost a dedicated person, a man who stands his ground and believe his commitment for the love of country. These Cayman Islands and its citizens. 4 years ago, Cayman Islands were in quagmire. PPM was elected with Alden at the reins. From day one, he rolled up his sleeves with his party team elected and went to work to stop the hemorrhaging. Took control of these islands, working day and night and burning the midnight oil. From gloom and doom, Alden and the PPM team took us to the glimmer of hope and now the light at the end of the tunnel. Alden and the PPM team have said, work still needs to be done, as it's a work in progress. Alden doesn't flinch, always lucid in dealing with the problems at hand, and most important, the solutions. Alden is not a globetrotter and returns empty promises and broken dreams. Alden has a vision, and along with the party, has set their course for the betterment for the people of the islands, and not just for the present, but also paving the path for the future generations. This is the Alden we all know. And on the 24th of May, I, Brian Bodden, am putting my ex by Alden McLaughlin's name, and I'm asking you all to do the same. So he can continue what he has started because he is a man of action. Thank you.
BB, thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, why is it you keep forgetting you can do better than that? So, we've had our endorsers. They've all spoken nice things. You've heard from Roy M. You've heard from Miss Lucille Dell. And I still not gonna tell you anything about the barbershop. But ladies and gentlemen, I just want you to know that these 4 years have been not only the most exciting times for me as your representative, but the most rewarding 4 years that I have spent as an elected member for the District of Georgetown, because I was with a team that could get the job done, wanted to get the job done, and got the job done. And everyone on that team, every one of them, brought something to the table that filled the whole picture out the right way. We have some new additions to the team, which you are continuing to hear about. And they too will bring more things to the table to fill everything out properly. But right now, I want to introduce you once more to my good friend, my colleague, the best Minister of Finance the country could ever have, Marco Archer.
Coming to you live and direct from Georgetown Central. Ladies and gentlemen, there are all kinds of politicians. There are those who entertain, there are those who embarrass, and there are those who simply inform. I am not the entertainer. I have no desire to embarrass, but I certainly wish to inform. Tonight, I want to speak to you about cost of living. And it is often confused with cost of doing business. They're not the same. One has the ability to influence the other. Cost of living has to do with the general price level within the country. Cost of doing business has to do with the government's fees and taxes. Now, the government is often blamed for the cost of living. But I'll tell you the honest truth. The government has limited control over the cost of living. It has far more control over the cost of doing business, and that is what we have been doing for the last 4 years. You see, the cost of living can be influenced by factors that are both external and internal. The price of oil has a great impact on the cost of living. The price of oil fluctuates. It has been on a downward trajectory for quite some time, but now it's creeping back up, simply because of geopolitical events in recent months. Instability within the Middle East. All those things influence the price of oil. Now, most economies produce electricity using fossil fuels. There aren't many that use nuclear or solar, even though solar is growing and we're going to be using that in Cayman in greater abundance or greater frequency. But most countries use fossil fuels. Therefore, when the price of oil rises, the cost of electricity rises, all businesses use electricity. So therefore, the price passes on to the business and then to the consumer. So geopolitical events can affect the price of oil. Other things that affect the price of the goods that we purchase in the stores include drought. Many of you would know that for the last 4 years, the state of California has been going through a severe drought. And ladies and gentlemen, I apologize. I do not give very sexy, entertaining speeches. My speeches are meant to inform so that when you hear someone speaking and they are incorrect, you're no different. An informed mind is far more valuable than a loquacious tongue or someone who likes to babble. The state of California has experienced a severe drought. California produces one-third of all the fruits and vegetables grown in America. So if one-third of your supply is severely impacted, the price increases for the simple reason the population doesn't decrease just because the supply of fruits and vegetables decreased. The same number of people are looking for those goods, and therefore the price will rise accordingly. When Foster's, Kirk's, Hurley's, or whomever, wherever, whatever, imports those fruits and vegetables, the price, the increased price that they experience is passed on to the consumer. Fruits and vegetables are a necessity. But ladies and gentlemen, many of them attract very little duty. In fact, I'm going to speak to you tonight about a list of food items that are duty-free. And not many of you know that they are duty-free. And it is the role of the government to inform its citizens. So, natural disasters, weather phenomenon, they affect prices overseas. Our merchants import the inflated price. There are other things such as disease. You would have noticed that sometime last year, a dozen eggs no longer cost $3 or $4. It had gone to somewhere around $7 or $8. The reason being is that a significant number of the egg-laying chicken population in America had suffered a severe disease and had to be put down. I forget that word, euthanized, I think that's the word. Euthanized, otherwise put to death. Now again, when the supply decreases, the population remains the same, the demand remains the same, the price can only go up. The merchants import that, they import the inflated price. You see it, you experience it. Many people, because they know no better, blame the government. And ladies and gentlemen, regardless of which administration is in office, the government should not be blamed for something that is beyond and beyond its control. I'm a very fair person. If it's you to blame, I'll blame you. If it's not you to blame, I won't blame you. And I expect the same for myself. Now, having spoken to you about external factors over which we have no control whatsoever, I will speak to you about the domestic factors. One of the things that has the greatest impact on the cost of doing business. And I want to distinguish between the cost of living and the cost of doing business. The cost of doing business will influence the cost of living. One of the things that has the greatest impact on the cost of doing business is government taxes. Now, answer me this question. What have we done with taxes in the last 4 years? We promised no new taxes. Did we introduce any new taxes? What did we do with taxes? We reduced the taxes. Ladies and gentlemen, for the emphasis of repetition and memory, we reduced import duty on consumable items by 2%. We took it from 22% down to 20%, and we have further to go. And if you re-elect us on May 24th, look forward to even more duty reductions. We reduced the duty on diesel that CUC uses to produce electricity by 50 cents per gallon. It was at 75 cents per gallon. We took it down to 25 cents. 75 minus 25, 50. That had a significant impact on people's electrical bills. And I want to be fair. I never give the critics an opportunity to say something before I say it. We were assisted by falling oil prices, but nevertheless, we kept our promise that we would reduce the duty on diesel, and therefore the government deserves to be recognized, and that fact should be appreciated. The government gave up $17 million in revenue by reducing the duty on diesel. Compare that to the previous government. And I'm going to speak to you about the importance of fiscal stability. I'm going to speak to you about the importance of fiscal stability. If I forget, you remind me. We also introduced legislation to regulate utilities. Our utilities are water, light, telephone, and fuel. We have created one body, the Utility Regulatory Commission, or otherwise called ERCO. I much prefer the Utility Regulatory Commission. ERCO sounds like Urkel, the old TV show. The purpose of that is to ensure that the government has the necessary information to monitor profit margins. Monitor profit margins and take the necessary action if the necessary action becomes necessary. We do not want to engage in price control as a first step. But if it becomes a last resort, we would then have the information available to us that we can make an informed decision and not a knee-jerk reaction. We also reduce the fees for trade and business licenses for micro and small businesses. Micro businesses are those with 0 to 4 employees. Small businesses are those with 5 to 12 employees. We reduced the fees tremendously. And I want to avoid that word too, because that's a bit overused. The fact is, we reduced the fees to a great extent. When we did that, we saw the number of small businesses, micro businesses, skyrocket. It now costs you only $75 to open a micro business. Compare that to the hundreds of dollars that it used to cost before we took the decision. I'm referring to the licenses, of course, on those small businesses, the trade and business license for those micro and small businesses. Can we get LED lights next time? Those are hot. So we reduced the fees on micro and small businesses, the trade and business license fees. Ladies and gentlemen, when you do those things, you create an environment that encourages people to open businesses. You reduce the startup costs. When you reduce the startup costs, You encourage and create greater opportunities for businesses to be more successful. Many businesses fail because they are not properly capitalized and they fail within the first year. Reduce the cost of doing that. Reduce the cost of startup, and you help those businesses stand a better chance of being more successful. That is what a responsible government does. I just spoke to you about food items. How many of you? I won't ask that question. The fact is, not many people know the vast number of food items that are duty-free. We go to the store, and we do not know that these things are duty-free. And then you hear people on the radio making all sorts of accusations, saying things that have absolutely no basis, no substance, no truth. The government should do this, the government should do that. Ladies and gentlemen, can you take anything lower than zero taxes on an item? You can't make it any cheaper. Chicken is duty-free. Milk is duty-free. Fish is duty-free. Hot cereal is duty-free. Cold cereal is duty-free. Coffee, tea, spaghetti, and I could go on and on and on and not stop till the break of dawn. They are all duty-free. I love to inform. I believe that an informed mind is a much more valuable individual. I asked the Department of Government Information Services, I said, these items are duty-free. I want you to produce a video that informs the public that these items are duty-free. I ask you to please tune in to GIS TV and look for that infomercial, and you will know the number of items that are duty-free. And I have said to merchants, I intend to inform the populace just so they can know what is duty-free. And if their knowledge in some way puts pressure on you, so be it. My responsibility is to the people, to ensure that the people get a fair deal. If they experience price increases overseas, so be it. You have to pay what the price is. But if there are exorbitant profit margins, I want you to know it is duty-free, and therefore, with your knowledge, you can speak up and say, why is that so expensive? I just told my friend.
You are just the best informer we've ever had.
Not informer.
Informer. I said informer.
I provide the best information, perhaps, okay, is what you meant to say. Ladies and gentlemen, the importance of financial stability is that it ensures that the government is able to provide on a consistent basis the services, the goods and services that you have become accustomed to receiving on a consistent basis. If we fail to exercise due regard to prudent fiscal practices and principles of financial management, we run the risk of spending more than we raise in ordinary taxes, and I use the word ordinary, because when we do that, the only solution is to either increase taxes or to go and borrow more money. Raise your hand if you want either of the two. Those on television, you can't see it, but I'm telling you, no one raised their hand because it's common sense. Now, compare this administration to the previous administration. It was very simple. They were asked to reduce expenditure by $25 million. They were clueless. They did not know what to do. The only thing they could think of was to raise taxes. Ladies and gentlemen, there's something called a propensity to consume. If you get extra money, your expenditure rises to meet that extra money. The trick is to control the expenditure, not look for more revenue. Control the expenditure. That is what they were being asked, that is what they were asked to do. They didn't know how to do it. So then they increase taxes on you, and they want you to believe that the country was so broke, that the previous administration before them had left the country so broke that they had no alternative to impose all of those taxes on you. If the country was so broke, then how could they spend so much money so recklessly with nothing to show for it? $5 million traveling. Ladies and gentlemen, I am going to get the figure, and I'm going to speak publicly about it. And I can almost say with great certainty, for the 4 years that we have been in office, our expenditure on travel has not reached anywhere near $1 million. How can one individual spend $5 million? Fiscal responsibility, fiscal stability. If you do not know what to do, you do what comes natural. You panic and you do foolishness. So we promised no new taxes because I understand propensity to consume, the marginal propensity to consume. If you get an extra dollar in income, you tend to spend more of it. The key is to not spend more of it. Control your expenditure. They keep saying, oh, you made a surplus because we left you with all sorts of revenue. No. We made a surplus because we had the sense to reduce expenditure and create the environment that gave confidence to investors that they would invest and the economy would grow. And when the economy grew, the revenue increased. With the revenue increasing and expenditure being controlled, that is how we grew the surplus. We did not do it on the backs of the people. We did not increase the government's revenue and surplus on the backs of the people. That is an irresponsible way to govern a country. There's nothing worse than doing something and blaming it on someone else. Country is so broke, $5 million traveling. A nation building fund that really and truly had very little benefit to very few. It was just wasteful spending. But the country was so broke. $6 million left in the hands of the developer of the Ritz-Carlton Hotel. Add 6, 5, and 9. How much do you get? How much? 20 million. They were being asked to reduce expenditure by 25. They had it right there in their hands. They had it right there in their hands. One simple thing that we did, the government had started charging itself import duty. A government department imported something, they paid customs department import duty. Think of it now, think of it. Your expenditure is supported by your revenue. Your revenue is derived from taxes or borrowing. If you reduce your expenditure, you can reduce your taxes or your borrowing. You can reduce the need for revenue. Very simple. We said, this is ludicrous. We will not charge the government taxes. We will not charge the government import duty. The government should not charge the government import duty. It saved us $2 million. Just by applying a little common sense. It saved us $2 million in expenditure because for the customs department and for the government, it was not real revenue. It was going from one hand to the next. It was not real revenue that was derived from providing goods and services to the general public. So ladies and gentlemen, I do not want to hog all of the time, but I just want you to understand, remember, repeat, and defend fiscal stability. is paramount. It is most important to a government being able to control the cost of doing business. If you control and reduce the cost of doing business, you therefore help to keep the cost of living at a minimum, except for the external factors that I just spoke of. Now I want you to say every day to everyone, amateur hour in the parliament has just been canceled. On May 24th, vote straight, vote red, vote progressives. From Georgetown Central all the way, Marco Archer, May 24th. Good night. Could you be loved?
So I want to be very, very careful now so I don't mislead anybody. But I think that's the best set of information that we've had in a long time. That's okay? Is that okay?
Yeah, man.
How I said it? Good.
Yeah,
but you see, ladies and gentlemen, that is just a taste of the team that we have. And until somebody tells me to say otherwise, I still say that we have. I know where I am, I know that. But it's still our team. Ladies and gentlemen, there are many out there who say that they deserve a vote. But look at what has gone on over the last 4 years. Think back. 4 years ago and 4.5 years ago, where this country was. Every single thing was topsy-turvy. Every morning you woke up, what's the next scandal? If you got through by midday, what's the next crisis? I'm not joking. I'm serious because I want you to understand that even when we were in opposition, it still worried us. And let nobody fool you. I don't know about anybody else. But I don't take any pleasure if I am in opposition to know that my country is going wrong, because it is not for me to make something happen to the country so that when I go to campaign, I can say that these people did bad things. That does not give me pleasure. But if it happened, it happened. And I'm here to tell you, it happened. And then along came the sea of red. And on that sea, beautiful ship came on. And the crew which sailed that ship in very late May of 2013 were all dressed in red. The captain was young enough, vibrant enough, but experienced enough to run a good ship. He knew, like all of the crew, that there were some uncharted waters, so we had to tread carefully. But what we also knew is that we had confidence in every one of the crew members, because every one of them had a separate job to do. But while they had a separate job to do, they still all had to work together to keep the ship upright, to keep it moving forward, carefully when you had to, but keep it headed in the direction to safe harbor. Ladies and gentlemen, here we are, 4 years later. We are in safe harbor. But we now have to take on stores. We have to load up once more and make the journey back so that we can feel satisfied that all of our people have all that they need and that there is a bright future for all of us to look forward to. And ladies and gentlemen, here to speak to you now is the captain of that wonderful ship, your premier and your next premier, the Honorable Alden McLaughlin.
When they're running down our country, man, they're walking on the fighting side of me. They're walking on the fighting side of me. Running down a way of life our fighting men have fought and died to keep. If you don't love it, leave it. Let this song that I'm singing be a warning. When you're running down our country horse, you're walking on the fighting side of me. I read about some squirrely guy who claims that he just don't believe in fighting. And I wonder just how long the rest of us can count on being.
Good evening, Red Band Prospect. So good to have so many of you here. I can't see a soul, but I can hear you. I was just saying to Miss Daphne, I wish I could sing like you. Because I would have sang that song, but if I sang that, everybody would get up and leave. But thank you all so much for coming out. Really, thank you. And thank you to the endorsers on behalf of Miss Lucille and on behalf of myself. Thank you for all the wonderful things you've said about us tonight. We promise you, we won't let you down. Now, we can't forget, in the midst of all of it, that this is a Red Bay and Prospect meeting. Now, those of us who have lived here for a long time, Miss Lucille has been here for 33 years in the Prospect community. I've lived here for 25. We know that really the line that has gone down behind my friend Fred Whitaker's house in Party Lane that divides Red Bay from Prospect is just an artificial line on the electoral map, that really Red Bay and Prospect are one community. Miss Lucille, come here a little bit. You see this? This is the team for Prospect and Red Bay. There ain't no better. Ain't no better. You see this lady here? I known her before I know myself. Her mother, Miss Maude, used to work with my mother, Althea, at the hospital. When I was that height, I know Miss Lucille. I know what she's made of. I know what she's done. I know what she's capable of. She ran against me one time, you know. Yeah, in 2000, she ran against me. The first time that I was elected, she lost by 53 votes. But after that, me and her kissed and made up. And in 2005, we ran together and we won. She helped us form the Progressives in 2002, and she's a founding member of that, and she has been with us through thick and thin, through winning and through losing, and she's still here. Don't make no Johnny come lately who don't live in Prospect, who don't know anything about Prospect, who never really had a job until he got a talk show position, come and tell you that he can represent Prospect better than Lucille Seymour. Don't make them do that. And folks, we have worked together through all the years that I have been in politics since we formed the Progressives, 2002. Until now, this is 2017, Miss Lucille and I. And I am honored and privileged that we are in adjoining districts or constituencies. And we are already working together. One of the things that we have agreed to do, we've talked about the district councils. We are definitely going to make that happen. Prospect will have its district council, and Red Bay will have its district council. Each of us will attend the meetings there, at least on a quarterly basis. But we are also going to have constituency offices. Ms. Lucille and I are going to get one constituency office suitably located roughly in the middle of these two constituencies, which will be fully staffed, where you, as our constituents of Red Bay and Prospect, are able to come and see us. If we are not there, able to make an appointment, to make an inquiry, that we can help with issues in these two electoral districts of Red Bay and Prospect. That's called teamwork. Ask the independents to understand that word. Already, we have been working on the development, on acquiring the property for the development of a park in Prospect. I just spoke to Minister Tibbetts, and we are that close to acquiring the land so that we can proceed once we get through this little matter of the elections to develop a proper park for the Prospect and Red Bay area, a place with a walking track, a place where people in the community can take their families and enjoy their amenities. Those are a couple of the things that we are already working on, we already have underway. We know, because we live in this community, we know the issues with respect to roads. And now that we are in single member electoral districts, we are better placed to be able to focus on those smaller constituency issues. We're going to improve the roads right across Red Bay and Prospect. We know that there is a major issue with littering, particularly the vacant lots that are overgrown, where people just go and dump stuff. We are going to deal with that. We know there are concerns about the frequency of garbage collection. We are going to press to change that and increase the frequency of garbage collection. Those are just some of the constituency issues that we are aware of, because we live in this community and we talk to the people in this community. All of them that just come from, Lord knows where they come from, they just land here in Prospect and Red Bay and say they're going to provide representation to the people of Red Bay and Prospect. They don't know nothing about you. Ladies and gentlemen, every election is about choice. And once you're elected, government is about choice. A government has to decide on what its priorities are, decide on how it is going to address the various issues that it faces. That was the situation with us when we took office in 2013. We only won 9 of the 18 seats, and Lord bless her. But Juliana O'Connelly, I called her, and she said, "Premier, forget about whether I was with the UDP or whether I was with the PNM, I can't remember what it was called again. The PNA. I am a Caymanian first, a Cayman Bracker, and I want to help provide good government for this country. I can join the Progressives." And she did. And she did. And so we then had the majority and we moved on, and as they say, the rest is history. We had the benefit of bringing some really good people on board, Minister Tara Rivers. I hope and I pray and I know she's going to win her seat in West Bay South, because she's going to be with us again. And then Brother Roy saw the error of his ways as running as an independent. And he came and he said, Premier, I see what you all are doing. He didn't do it overnight, you know. He didn't do it overnight. He said, I want to be a part of this wonderful thing called the Progressives, because I understand now, in a way I didn't before, how important it is to have teamwork. Because by yourself, you may have the greatest ideas in the world, you may have the best ability in the world, but you really can't do much. And so we put together a government. Minister Archer mentioned some of the issues that we faced. We had a situation where the United Kingdom government was saying we have to keep reducing expenditure, reducing the government budget and our government's ability to do things, to hire civil servants, to increase civil servant salaries, to do projects, to find money for things like social services and for education. Every year they're saying you have to reduce the amount of money that you spend, because the truth is the government financial situation was not good. We were spending more money than we were making in terms of revenue. Government debt was increasing. Minister Archer and I and Minister Wayne Panton got on British Airways and we went to London. Within a month of taking office, we sat down around the table with their economists and we said, and Minister Archer led the discussion on the economic side. But back then he was a young politician, so I had to be there to make sure that the politics was right, because they need to understand the politics too. But we told them we will go back home and we will produce a 3-year plan which will deliver for this country and to you and to satisfy you that we have this country back on track, that we will be back in surplus budgets, that all of the various requirements of the public management and finance law will be complied with in 3 years. I can't tell you they believed us, but they certainly had enough confidence in us to say, okay, you go ahead. We will not insist on these tight spending reins. And ladies and gentlemen, there is nothing as sweet as proving to those who believe you can't do it that you've done it. And that we have. Over the course of these past 4 years, cumulatively, we have created a budget of a surplus of $414 million. We've got almost $100 million in general reserves. We've paid down government debt by $125 million. We've given civil servants back their 3.2% that McKeever had taken from them, then given them back, then taken again. We gave them 4% increase in salary plus 2 bonus, how you call them? Two bonus or honorariums of 2.5% and 3% over the course of this term. We have addressed the issue of pay stagnation in the civil service. Many civil servants were stuck at a particular salary point, and civil servants or new civil servants who joined without experience and without the tenure were getting paid more than them, particularly teachers, police officers, fire officers, prison officers. We have addressed all of those issues. And ladies and gentlemen, we never increased taxes or fees once over the course of the 4 years. Some of our opposition say that was luck, that was chance. As I said the other night, I don't believe too much in those things, luck or chance. Everything I've ever achieved in my life has been the result of thought, hard work, and planning. I don't believe too much in this business about chance. And so, ladies and gentlemen, we have got this country back on course. Unemployment was at 10.5% when we took office. It is now, the last published report had it at 7.1 for Caymanians. We know the forecast, because the last survey has just been completed, and the forecast is that it is falling again to about 6% for this past quarter, and over the course of the next year, it is expected to fall to 4.3%. All of the indications are that the economy is continuing to grow, and economic opportunities and employment opportunities for Caymanians are continuing to increase. The country is on the right course. Now, ladies and gentlemen, I am not going to try to say that everything is perfect. Nobody grasped the brass ring every time. Did we get everything right? Absolutely not. But I am here to tell you, you can look around, you can question as much as you wish. Ask yourself if you can find 10 of those who are putting themselves forward as the independents that you believe can best the job, can best the team that we have. Because you need at least 10 to form the government. Which one of them, aside from Kenneth Bryan, is going to do Minister Archer's job as Minister of Finance? Ladies and gentlemen, as good a job as Marco has done, he could not do it by himself. It requires a team who understand these issues and are prepared to help and to support. Without the growth in tourism, as a result of the vision and endeavor of the Deputy Premier and Minister of Tourism, Moses Kirkconnell, and the Councillor, Joey Hugh, we wouldn't have the revenue so that we could be able to do the things that we've been able to do. Similarly, with Minister Wayne Patton and his stewardship of financial services, assisted by Councillor Roy McTaggart, we would not have gotten there. You see all of those roads that are being built? They just happened by magic. That big man behind me who held the mic all night, Minister Kurt Tibbetts, he is the man who spearheaded all of that. They seem to think, those are just some examples. All the work that has been done in education, they think it just happened so. Minister Tara Rivers has led that charge. My point, ladies and gentlemen, in saying these things, yes, and Minister Osborne Borden, who has been the Minister for Community Affairs and for Sports, who has championed many things, including the older person's policy, and is working hard to reform the issues around social services, particularly as it relates to the needs assessment unit and the community, the Department of Children and Family Services. My point, ladies and gentlemen, is these things don't just happen. They require leadership and teamwork. Leadership and teamwork. I want you to look around at the independents, and everywhere I look, there's another sign going up saying, vote for independence, vote for independence. Those people who believe, I'm not saying that people could not get invited in, could not get elected as independents, or that independents have no use. Not at all. Councillor Roy McTaggart was elected as an independent, but he joined our government because he understood that he could get nothing done by himself, regardless of how bright he is, regardless of how good the ideas are. You can't even move a motion in the Legislative Assembly unless you have at least one person who's prepared to second it. You have to have a team to govern this country. So ask the independents to tell you what their plan is with respect to education, with respect to healthcare, with respect to finances, with respect to community services. And if they have one, which I doubt, ask them how they're going to get these things done that they are promising you. Because that is the key question. In order to get anything done, they have to have a minimum of 10 people who are prepared to support what they are doing. Don't let the rhetoric and the talk and the excitement around elections cause you, ladies and gentlemen, to forget the reality of the political process and of government. It requires a majority in the House to get anything done. Independents by themselves cannot do it. Ladies and gentlemen, I've thought long and hard about this, and I've put this off for a long time. But tonight, after I have seen the video that Kenneth Bryan has put around, where he promotes the speech that I made 4 years ago, endorsing him and telling the people to vote for him, and that I thought he would be a good representative. And he says, after he runs that, "I was good then, I'm good now. It's just politics why Alden is not supporting me." Ladies and gentlemen, I knew Kenneth had a troubled past. I decided, and I convinced many people on my team then, some who were not too happy about it, that everybody deserves a second chance, even a third chance sometimes, because that's the way I am. How could I go out and tell employers they should hire somebody who has been convicted of a serious offense when I, as premier, would not do that myself, or as leader of the party at that time? That's how I look at life. I looked at Kenneth like he was one of my sons. Give him a chance. He ran the election. He didn't win. He had no job. He had a family, mortgage to pay. I took him on as my political assistant, because that's how I am. I ain't gonna go into all of the problems that we had with that. But I'm going to tell you why, when he says he was good then, he's good now. I'll tell you what made all the difference with me. All of you would have been familiar by all of the news coverage of the fact that Kenneth was arrested for assaulting a police officer outside a nightclub. He was subsequently charged and subsequently convicted. And after that, I terminated him. But what people are not aware of, because I haven't made it public, is that that was not the first time during the term that he was my political assistant, that he had been arrested by the police. The first time, and I didn't even know anything about it, because, of course, some people may think that I intervened. I did not know about this until senior police and the commissioner told me. They had arrested him previously for a similar thing of obstructing police in the exercise of their duty, telling them, "You know who I am? I'm the political assistant to the premier." And they warned him more than once not to interfere. And when he wouldn't stop, they arrested him. And they took him to the station. But the officer in charge understood full well the implications of charging the political assistant to the premier with that offense. And so he gave him a talking to and did not proceed with any charges. So when you hear what happened at Next Level afterwards, the police had every right to be more than fed up with this individual who kept interfering with them doing their duties. Now, I, as the premier of this country, who has responsibility for the police budget and who is invited to regular police briefings about what is going on with the governor, how can I have as my political assistant someone who clearly has no regard for authority, no regard for the police? I did what I had to do. And whatever the consequences are, the consequences are. But I stand for what is right. I gave Kenneth every opportunity I possibly could to make something of himself. But I am telling you tonight, without fear of successful contradiction, Kenneth lacks the maturity, lacks the restraint that is required to be a good representative. And if he's elected, he is going to cause no end of problems. No end of problems. Aside from the fact that he claims to be better at finance than Minister Archer, but we will leave that alone. So, ladies and gentlemen, this is where we are. We are 23 days away from Election Day. We have a new electoral system. And I know it's very tempting for many people to vote for somebody that they like. Just give him a vote. Under the old system, you had 6 votes in Georgetown. You give this one a vote because you like him. But this time, your vote really, really matters. It really, really matters. Ladies and gentlemen, we, this country, cannot afford a coalition of chaos, because that is exactly what is going to happen if we wind up with a bunch of independents scrambling the morning after election to try to form a government. Ladies and gentlemen, most of them are completely and utterly clueless. Most of them don't even have a job. They're asking you to give them a job. I have no illusions about this responsibility. I have been elected 4 times. I have held every position besides Speaker. Now, I understand this. Believe you me, I understand this. When I was first elected in 2000 with Minister Tibbetts, and we were forced to put together a coalition government, I fought, even though I was a complete and utter political novice, to have him as the leader of government business, as the position was called at the time, because I knew that was a man I could trust. That government lasted 1 year before it fell apart. You know why? Because the people who had been elected, and particularly those in cabinet, had never sat down together as we have done and said, argued about these issues and said, this is our policy with respect to financial services. This is our policy with respect to education. This is our policy with respect to healthcare, and so on and so forth. So the world doesn't stop just because the government got elected. The demands of government continue, and expectations of people are very great. You have to hit the ground running with a plan that you know, as we did. The only reason that we could do what we did, when I talked to you about Minister Archer, myself, and Minister Panton going to the UK to talk to them about the financial situation in this country, we had spent months working out what it was that we needed to do. The country will be asking for disaster and chaos if we wind up with a situation where we have a whole bunch of independents who have never talked to each other about these issues, scrambling after Election Day, as one of them said in the Red Bay Forum, first thing I go do is I go in to count the money because I don't believe government figures. So they have no appreciation of what it takes to run a country. Ladies and gentlemen, it's the same in government as it is with any business. You have to have a board of directors who are moving in the same direction. Yes, they may disagree internally, but they come to a collective decision about what to do. Whether it's a football team or a baseball team, you have to have teamwork to achieve any level of success. Ladies and gentlemen, the Progressives has by far the best team in this race. There is no question, there is no question that the people on this team are eminently qualified to do the job of governing the country. And ladies and gentlemen, in case they forget, we have a track record that we can stand on. I am not here pleading with you for another chance to fix stuff that we screwed up. We did not. We have done a good job. We have delivered on our promises. We have, ladies and gentlemen, built the foundation brick by brick. We have the rest of the plans drawn. And over the course of the next 10 days, we will deliver to you our new manifesto telling you how we plan to take this country to higher heights over the course of the next 4 years when you re-elect the Progressives to office. Ladies and gentlemen, Ms. Lucille Seymour for Prospect. Mr. Roy McTaggart, Georgetown East. Ms. Daphne Orrett, who McKeever is very, very afraid of. West Bay West. David White, Georgetown West. Maxine Borden Robinson, Bordentown West. Barbara Connolly, Georgetown South. And Marco Archer, the man who got the biggest fight of all, Georgetown Central. And Kurt Tibbetts for Northward. Joey Hugh, Georgetown North. And even though I can't see very well, he's such a big, solid fella. I believe I see Wayne Patton out there. Newlands. And although he's not here, Osborne Borden, Bordentown East. Ed Chisholm, Northside. Heather Borden, Savannah. And a shout out for Tara Rivers, West Bay South. Now we're going Cayman Brack. Now we're going Cayman Brack. Juliana O'Connor Connolly, Cayman Brack East. And Moses Ian Kakernel, Cayman Brack and Little Cayman, Cayman Brack West. And I beg you, ladies and gentlemen, if you live in Red Bay, give me one little vote. Thank you all. Good night.
When they're running down a country man, they-